Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Jenny O'Ruth on education reform. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary around 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I just want to briefly pay tribute to Winnie Ewing, a giant of our movement, of course, in the Scottish National Party, and send condolences to our friends and colleagues Annabel and Ewing on the sad loss of their mum. Presiding Officer, I set out the vision and values produced by the National Discussion on Education 3 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, the Government published James Withers' report on the skills delivery landscape. Today, I will update Parliament on the final report of the independent review of qualifications and assessment led by Professor Louise Hayward. And next week, Parliament will receive an update on the purpose and principles for post-school education, research and skills. There's a lot happening in the policy world of Scottish education. And that external context, when considering the internal context in our classrooms at the present time, is a point I will return to in my statement. Presiding Officer, the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment is a detailed and comprehensive report which sets out 26 recommendations. It is a culmination of the work undertaken over the last year by Professor Louise Hayward and by her independent review group involving a wide range of stakeholders. I'm grateful to Professor Hayward and to everyone who shared their views with the review, and I commend the inclusive and transparent approach that has been taken. The final report recommends a Scottish Diploma of Achievement should be the graduation certificate offered in all settings where senior phase education is provided. The report suggests that all learners should be provided the opportunity to experience learning in the diploma programmes of learning, project learning and a personal pathway. In respect to the programmes of learning, the review recommends that learners should continue to study subjects at vocational, technical and professional qualifications. A wider range of methods of assessment should be adopted, and the number of examinations in the senior phase reduced, with removal of exams suggested at the end of S4. In project learning, the review explains that learners would have the opportunity to apply the knowledge and skills they developed in a real-world situation by undertaking a project or a significant question or problem important to them. And the focus of the personal pathway is a reflection on learning, whether that be learning in school, in college or in the community. The purpose is to give learners the opportunity to personalise their diploma by selecting aspects of their interests that reflect aspects of their experiences rather that reflect their interests and the contributions that they make to society and their career aspirations. The review recommends that there should be a digital profile for all learners which allows them to record personal achievements, identify and plan future learning. And the report also highlights the need to support the system through any process of change with phasing and timing linked to the resources available. The recommendations, if implemented, could represent very significant change to our qualification system offered by Scotland schools and colleges. Presiding Officer, the recommendations for reform in this report could really amount to a radical shift in Scottish education. And as Cabinet Secretary, I need to be certain that these changes are the right ones for Scotland's young people. To that end, and before I arrive at a conclusion on these proposals, I need to hear from our teachers, particularly our secondary teachers, who will be key to driving any changes we deliver in the qualification system. And I must also be mindful of that wider policy context, as I've outlined, with four substantive reports publishing within 4 weeks. Government now requires to provide an overarching narrative which ties these outputs together, to set that clear trajectory of travel and not to miss the inherent opportunities which exist. And we also need to learn lessons on educational reform. As the report notes of Curriculum for Excellence, when they asked for support, more guidance was developed. What teachers wanted was practical support. And when I visit schools, Presiding Officer, it's not advice and guidance that teachers want. It's very often practical help in responding to things like additional support needs, behaviour and relationships post-COVID, and seeking to improve parental engagement. So I need to be certain that our reform agenda is ambitious enough to deliver on that expectation. Now, as we've discussed in the Chamber in recent weeks, the culture in our schools has changed post-pandemic, and we know that's impacting on attendance. We also know that schools are responding to a cost of living crisis and to other external challenges, from artificial intelligence to global instability. Both the Hayward Report and the National Discussion talk to this uncertainty. So government must provide leadership on reform which addresses this new normal in our school communities. Presiding Officer, in evidencing that leadership, I have concluded that it is not the time to introduce legislation on educational reform now. Any reform which meets our ambitions for our young people will need to be bold, it will need to be holistic, and crucially, it will have to be shaped by the expertise of our teachers. I am determined to give this process the time needed to ensure that happens before bringing forward legislation in the next parliamentary year. The immediate challenges faced by the teaching profession in responding to our post-pandemic school communities won't be helped by legislation, nor can I really expect meaningful engagement on our future qualifications if Parliament is focused on legislating for these bodies. Instead, focus must be brought back to our children and young people and improving their educational outcomes. It must be on delivering excellent learning and teaching for all. And that has to be the component parts of our education system working together in a spirit of partnership. We need to take this opportunity to design our national education and skills landscape in its totality to better support children, young people and our adult learners. Now, preempting what is possible in the context of the new bodies by drawing a narrower legislative focus at this stage would, I believe, miss that opportunity. If we are to deliver parity of esteem across the education system, then a holistic approach to legislation will be required. I recognise this announcement will have an impact on the staff at the SQA and Education Scotland, and I thank everyone in both organisations for their ongoing work to support Scotland's young people. I reiterate, of course, the Scottish Government's commitment to no compulsory redundancies as a result of the reform process. Presiding Officer, I reassure Parliament that work to deliver the new national education bodies will continue nonetheless at pace, strengthened by this extended period of engagement. We already have plans in place to recruit a new chair of the SQA who will lead the transition to the new qualifications body. Establishing leadership for the new independent inspectorate is also critical, and I want to start this process now, and therefore taking forward recruitment for HM's Chief Inspector of Education. Both of these posts will provide enhanced leadership to support the establishment of the new bodies and also to ensure that we deliver change in both practice and in culture. And as Cabinet Secretary, I will work together across parties in this Parliament to improve educational outcomes for all. This is a prize worth striving for, Presiding Officer. It's vital we get this right for the next generation. Throughout our education system, our learners, of course, are supported by excellent teachers and other professionals throughout their educational journey. And we want this support to continue as the effects of the pandemic continue to impact on our young people and those, of course, that we entrust in their care. I very much recognise the continuing pressures facing our teachers and our wider education workforce at this time. As a first step, I want to work with local government partners to ensure we have a comprehensive picture of the health and wellbeing support that is currently available and to identify how we can build on that. We also want to undertake a short, sharp review of the impacts that our regional improvement collaboratives have had in supporting our pupils and practitioners as part of our reformed system. And I'll work with COSLA, the RICS and others in that review, which will conclude in October. Presiding Officer, since taking up the post as Cabinet Secretary, I think it's important that we assess the ideas coming out of the national discussion and independent reviews in more detail. And my view on that as Cabinet Secretary is that there are a lot of reviews happening at a similar time, and it's important now we hear from the profession on the outputs of those reviews. I am determined that this process moves at pace and involves teachers and others working in education at the earliest possible opportunity. To that end, I've written to directors of education with a request to prioritise time to consider reform during in-service sessions in the new term. We will use the outputs from this feedback to provide a fulsome response from the government, and I commit to return to Parliament to fully debate the proposals in the review more extensively. Presiding Officer, good teaching continuously assesses to monitor progress, and we entrust a graduate workforce to do just that. The report, of course, takes the view that final examinations in S4 should end. Now, some purport this to be radical, but since the introduction of the National 4s back in 2013-14, learners taking these qualifications have already not been required to sit a final qualification. Now, critics at that time argued that devalued National 4, and it's likely, of course, that this did contribute to a level of over-presentation with more pupils being presented at National 5 qualification, as this was considered the more robust qualification due to the final exam element. And we like a test in Scottish education, and as Professor Gordon Stobart has observed, in comparative terms, Scottish upper secondary students are more frequently examined than those in other jurisdictions. This is a consequence of the tradition of offering three suites of examinations, National 5, Highers, Advanced Highers, during secondary years S4, S5 and S6. This is examination loading not found in other jurisdictions. Now, as a former teacher, I am fully supportive of more continuous assessment. Of course, that has to be managed appropriately, but a move away from high-stakes final exams will give a more holistic approach to assessment. It also means our young people won't face a cliff edge. And it's worth reflecting that the new national qualifications, as they originally operated, contained an element of continuous assessment through unit assessment. But the recording of outcome and assessment standards quickly became quite a burdensome bureaucratic task, which detracted from day-to-day learning and teaching. Now, ultimately, unit assessments were removed for that reason, but we need to learn lessons from that experience in designing with teachers continuous assessment practices that are proportionate, robust and enhanced rather than detract from learning and teaching. Presiding Officer, the independent reports by James Withers and Professor Louise Hayward have implications for learners of all ages across all settings, for teachers and practitioners, local and central government and our national bodies. And I would like to use the coming weeks and months to take forward detailed examination of the proposals, allowing Parliament and others across the system the opportunity to engage with and shape our response. Our response has to be holistic to reflect a single clear expectation, namely that from this reform process we will have a coherent education and skills system where every part works together and holds collective responsibility to deliver for learners of all ages. A coherent education and skills system that is focused on taking the best from our educational traditions, including our long-standing and well-recognised hires, and making sure we build on that success to help our learners go on achieving the very best they can. Change in education isn't always about inputs. In most, it's about the outcomes and about the lifetime satisfactions that come from every young person, every individual learner, being enabled to reach and often surpass their potential. And in the end, we must judge everything we do by those criteria, the need and the expectation of all those in our schools. If we can all agree on that, Presiding Officer, Scotland and Scotland's learners will be the winners. Surely that's worth working together to achieve, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I start by echoing the sentiments in relation to the passing of Winnie Ewing, obviously the first person to preside over this Parliament after its re-establishment in 1999, and send condolences to Fergus, Annabel Ewing and the wider family. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in our statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business, and I would urge members who haven't already done so but wish to ask a question to press the request to speak buttons, and I call for Stephen Kerr.
I wish to associate myself entirely with the sentiment you've just expressed in relation to the passing of Winnie Ewing. And I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. I also want to thank her for the effort she went to reach out to the parties in this Parliament. But expecting members to digest a 230-page report, complete with summaries and appendices, an hour before we have the statement, is obviously asking much of all of us. I hear the Minister saying slacker, but it's a lot of reading, even if you divide it up. It would appear that the Minister for Parliamentary Business was more interested in abiding to protocol than he was to enhancing scrutiny. It's worth working together, but to do that, we need to share our working. And I want to thank Professor Louise Hayward and everyone who worked with her to produce this review, and also the authors of the National Discussion, and the Withers Review, and the Muir Report. But let me not pussyfoot around the issue. These reports and reviews, combined with the output that we see from various sources, are a damning verdict on 16 years of SNP government. And based on the National Discussion, I think the Cabinet Secretary knows she has a long way to go in regaining the trust of teachers, parents and learners in delivering the practical support she mentioned in her statement. And the truth is, after all these reviews, and I think by her own word, we still have no clear sense of what the government's strategy is or its direction of travel. So, having said that, if Jenny Gilruth embraces the need for bold, innovative and urgent change that is better for learners, she will always have the support of these benches. Now, I have four short questions, which I'd like to give the Cabinet Secretary the opportunity to give four short answers. I can see the concern of the Deputy Presiding Officer. How does she assess the recommendations in the Hayward Review will change the commonly diagnosed issues of the senior phase, such as the two-term dash and teaching to the test? How does she envisage course assessment, other than examinations, would be externally verified? And what does that assessment mean in terms of teachers' workload? And does she agree that we must not do anything to diminish the standing or reputation of the higher and advanced higher in the eyes of employers and further in higher education? And does she agree that much more needs to be done to create parity of esteem for technical and professional qualifications in the education system overall?
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr. Kerr for his questions. I'm not sure, Presiding Officer, I'll be able to give a detailed response, but I'm more than happy to meet with him on the substantive questions he raises, because I think they're important points. The first question Mr Kerr poses relates to the two-term dash, of course, and I think the report talks to the challenge implicit in having a system which we currently have, which is wholly dependent or largely dependent on a final examination. That's one of the reasons why the report recommends, for example, that we remove final qualifications or final exams, rather, at the end of S4, so we can have a more continuous approach to assessment throughout the school year. And that might not be in one school year. It might be over the course of 2 years, for example. That in itself could remove the two-term dash. But I think it's really important that the practicalities of what is a very detailed report are now engaged with from the profession. I think it's hugely important, I hear, from the secondary teaching profession, because this will fundamentally change the type of learning and teaching, and actually the pedagogy, I think, that exists in our classrooms, particularly in the senior phase, if we're looking at a move towards continuous assessment. The second thing I would observe is that we always had continuous assessment. I was quite careful to make that point in my statement. It existed in standard grade to an extent. We always had end of unit tests, for example. It existed in the kind of architecture around curriculum for excellence when the new national qualifications came forward. And yet, we deviated back to a final exam system. Part of that related to the administration of the unit assessments, and I mentioned their removal. I think that was a test of the exam system, and I think it's hugely important that the new exams body, which will be key in that endeavour, works with the profession to deliver assessment criteria which are not adding to workload and actually help to improve the type of learning and teaching we have in our classrooms. Mr Kerr asked three other questions. I will try to touch on, Presiding Officer, mindful of time. I think I've answered the question around about workload. He talked about not doing anything to diminish higher and advanced higher, and I fully agree with that. I had a point about that in my summing up comments, Presiding Officer. I'm really keen that we do not deviate and we recognise the strength of Scottish education, particularly the gold standard in relation to our higher qualifications, but also actually parity of esteem. That's why we cannot read this report in a silo away from the recommendations from what James Withers has said. It's really important that these outputs come together and we do deliver that overarching narrative, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I want to thank Professor Hayward for her work, the people who engaged with it, and the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement and the conversation with us yesterday. Although, and I think she agrees, it would have been far more helpful to see the report before 1 hour ago. The Cabinet Secretary has herself acknowledged that this report is another in a long list of reviews, which has left teachers, pupils and parents waiting and anticipating change for some time. And of course, understanding and reviewing problems is necessary for change, but I think it's clear that what's needed now from the Government is leadership, clarity and action. And I, as others will, welcome the breadth of the report and the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to put teachers at the forefront of reforms. But as she takes the time to do that, there are significant questions around the suggested reforms that teachers, pupils and parents need more answers from the Cabinet Secretary today. The report recommends the removal of S4 exams, but it leaves questions on how children leaving after S4 will demonstrate their achievements. And significant reductions in high-stakes exams will have a huge potential impact on teacher workloads, leaving teachers worrying that it could increase. And so to settle some of this uncertainty early, I'd ask the Cabinet Secretary to consider this, especially in light of the commitment to reduce teacher contact time and to set out how this aspect of the reforms could work in that vital reform too. And finally,
both opening questioners have gone beyond the time allocation, which is going to eat into the time available for backbench questions. That is not acceptable. Cabinet Secretary, can you respond, please?
Presiding Officer, thank you. I think Ms Duncan-Glancy and also Mr Kerr referenced that they have not had enough time to digest the report, and I recognise the limitations around about publishing an embargoed report before giving a statement. I did undertake in my statement to come back to Parliament to debate more fully the outcomes of this report, but also I think to Ms Duncan-Glancy's fair question, which is in relation to the overarching narrative surrounding these four separate outputs. On the point she makes around about workload issues, I met with trade unions yesterday to discuss this issue, and I think it relates back to some of the points I made in response to Mr Kerr, which is about the implementation of the administration of what continuous assessment looks like. So when I reflect on my experiences of being in the classroom, say 10 years ago when we brought forward the new national qualifications, it became a bit of a tick box exercise, if I may say so. And I think the new qualifications body has a key role to play in that regard to ensuring that teacher workload is not increased as a result of these changes. And if I may also say to the member, if we are looking to move away from high-stakes final exams, we will also need to look at the percentage allocation, for example, that is applied to the final examination and the overall awarding of the qualification. Now, I don't think as Cabinet Secretary, in fact, I know, I don't have all the qualifications and expertise to make these decisions, but I very much trust Scotland's teachers to tell me so. They fed into the SQA's work in relation to developing the new national qualifications, and I fully expect them at a subject specialist level to feed into the work as we move forward with the recommendations from Hayward, because they have that subject expertise and they have the knowledge to ensure that we can deliver assessments that are balanced, but actually also that improve the learning and teaching, I think, that happens in our classrooms through continuous assessment.
Thank you. We have 11 members who want to ask questions. We've got 12 minutes, so the questions and the responses will need now to be as brief as possible. First, John Mason, to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you. There can sometimes be a difference between what young people are wanting to learn and from their education and what employers are looking for. Does the Cabinet Secretary think we're getting the balance right in that area?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the question the member poses is a really interesting one about the purpose of our education system. Is it just to prepare our children and young people for the world of work, or is it about giving them a well-rounded education which equips them with the necessary skills for life? I am inclined towards the latter, but I accept that what our employers need needs to be part of that broader consideration. We know now, we now have record numbers of young people going on to positive destinations, and I think that's certainly evidence of progress. There has been good progress, but nonetheless, we need to build on that. And that's why I think we need to have a holistic approach to where we go next, which is absolutely the reason why the outputs from the James Withers reviews need to be considered within this wider context in relation to education reform, particularly to answer the question, the member's question in relation to the needs of employers and that wider skills base.
Megan Gallagher, to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We have had review after review of our education system. I think we have had enough reviews to last this Parliament a lifetime. There is no strategy as of yet. From the statement today, more reviews will be undertaken before any direction will be given by this Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, I do understand that you have inherited a mess after 16 years of an SNP government. There is too much bureaucracy, too many education bodies and reforms that could bankrupt councils should
Question,
this government
please.
Not fund them correctly. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how many more statements will be made to this Parliament before we see legislation that will transform our education
Cabinet
system?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I agree to her to some extent in relation to the numbers of reviews and reports that have come to fruition at a similar time. But I think the member does a disservice to Scottish education when she describes it as a mess. Now, actually, we're starting to see real progress in relation to the poverty-related attainment gap closing. We're starting to see more young people going on to positive destinations. But I do recognise the need for that overarching narrative that government will provide. And I actually think it's important that Parliament talks about these things. And that's why I've committed to come back to Parliament to more substantively debate the outputs from this report, which, if enacted, could see radical changes for Scotland's children and young people. It's really important we get that change right. And as I committed in my statement, Presiding Officer, I will work across party divide to ensure that's what happens.
Marie McNair to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. None of these reforms are possible without our hard-working teachers, who are the lifeblood of our education system. Unfortunately, at the moment, many of them, especially those who have only served a couple of years' service, are struggling to obtain full-time permanent positions after they've finished their probation. I've had numerous constituents raise this issue with me. This is leading to many young teachers leaving the profession and tentatively seek work abroad. In light of the recommendations of the independent review and indeed the national discussion, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what further reforms he will bring forward to ensure our inviolable teachers remain in our education
Cabinet
system?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member raises a really important question. She may remember we faced similar challenges when I actually first qualified as a teacher in relation to staffing and how we can adequately attract people to the profession and also ensure that they're in the right parts of the country at the right time. There are lots of different ways in which we can do that. For example, the government offers a golden handshake for probationary teachers who are prepared to go anywhere. I was one of them back in 2007. And I think that's an important part of how we can attract people into the profession. However, there are other things that we will need to consider. I've started a conversation actually with the GTCS on this a couple of weeks ago, and we've been undertaking further work on this through the Scottish Education Council to consider the role in relation to staffing. Ultimately, I say to Parliament that staffing in relation to teacher numbers is a matter for local authorities. We have provided additionality in that respect, so over £145 million to protect increased teacher and support staff numbers. But I commit to working with COSLA on this issue because it's hugely important that we retain teachers in the teaching profession. And particularly given the fact that teachers in Scotland, of course, are now the best paid in the UK. We want to keep teachers in Scotland to help them be part of the journey in relation to education reform.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Ruth McGuire.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I welcome the fact that we have a statement that confirms we're going to have a pupil-centred education system, and also the Cabinet Secretary guarantee that we will have a graduate workforce that sits in front of those. But with regard to the educational reforms and the confirmation that she's made that there's not, now is not the right time to introduce legislation, does that mean that she's decided not to abolish the SQA, which is of course set up by the Scottish Qualifications Act?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. No, the SQA will be abolished. It will be replaced with a new qualifications body, and I want to put that on the record for absolute certainty. I think my reading of the report, and I appreciate members will not have had time to go through the report in all of its detail, there are a number of recommendations which have a bit of read across in relation to the reform agenda on these new bodies and what that will look like. And then, of course, we have the wider report landscape, as I outlined in my statement to Parliament. It's important we take account of both of those things through the legislative process. And I need to make sure that what comes next in relation to qualifications reform is fit for purpose. And actually, I think legislating at this current time wouldn't be the right thing to do. And that's why we've decided to pause for a year. But to confirm with the member, we will be legislating to remove the SQA.
Ms McGuire to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what more will be done to support the quality and consistency of the implementation of existing policies and practices which improve outcomes for children and young people?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Ruth McGuire is quite right to raise these issues because while we look to a bold and ambitious reform agenda, we can't lose sight of the key priorities in front of us right now. So I will continue to work with Education Scotland, with our local authorities and others, as we seek to deliver the best possible outcome for our children and young people. And of the utmost importance to this government is making progress in closing the poverty-related attainment gap. And our £1 billion of investment in the Scottish Attainment Challenge is really designed to do exactly that, including, of course, empowering our head teachers to use pupil equity funding to best support the children and schools impacted by poverty in their locality.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Rona Mackay.
I think I share the Education Secretary's caution in terms of the implementation of this report. There's an awful lot going on in terms of behaviour, the pandemic, closing the poverty-related attainment gap, which we're not quite making as much progress as she indicates, but also raising an international performance. But I am a bit concerned that she is delaying the reform of the national bodies by, it seems, by a year. It's important the profession has confidence in these national bodies. And I worry if it's delayed,
question,
then we'll have a real problem in inspiring confidence amongst the teachers. Can she assure me on that front?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member makes a really important point. I mean, my reflections on where Scottish education is at the current time, and we've talked about this in the Chamber at length in recent weeks, is it's facing a number of challenges. So we've talked about behaviour post-COVID, we've talked about the change in the culture in our schools, we've talked about excellence, and Willie Rennie makes reference to international surveys, for example. I think that's a hugely important step from the government, rejoining those international surveys. But it's also got to be about partnerships, because our local authorities are key to delivering quality learning and teaching in our schools. We need to have the faith of the profession, and the profession have been through quite a challenging time in relation to industrial relations. I'm glad that we've been able to resolve that dispute. However, I now need to work with our teaching profession. And what struck me as I've been going in and out of schools over the last couple of months is I'm not sure how many teachers have engaged with the national discussion and have engaged holistically with the outputs from the Hayward Review. I need to make sure that the teaching profession is engaged in the outputs of those reviews, and that does have an impact in relation to reform. So reform absolutely is coming in relation to these bodies, but I absolutely have to work with the teaching profession in relation to driving these reforms forward. I cannot foist change against the teaching system. I think I maybe know that better than others in this chamber.
OK, we've got less than 4 minutes. We've got five people that want to get in still. I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Any future education reform must proactively remove practical or discriminatory barriers to learning. What consideration is the Cabinet Secretary giving to the needs of those who may feel excluded or marginalised within the current education system?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that's a really important question, Presiding Officer, from Rona Mackay. She's absolutely right. The reform agenda that I'm committed to is one that has to secure better outcomes for all of our children. And a really crucial part of that will be in ensuring that remaining barriers to learning for those who feel marginalised by the current system are removed. The government, of course, is already taking steps to tackle specific barriers to education in relation to the work in the Scottish Attainment Challenge, also through the National Improvement Framework. I think more broadly, we've had good discussions in the Chamber in recent weeks in relation to challenges on behaviour and relationships, and we'll be taking work on that forward only next week, actually. But I hope that these changes and this support across the system in relation to improving inclusivity will be a driver behind our need for reform. One of the key outputs from the national discussion was that we have a really inclusive system in Scotland. It's important we use that strength to build on the changes we seek to bring forward in regard to reform.
To be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you. This review is the end result of an agreement reached between the Greens and the Scottish Government in 2020, and I'm delighted by its output. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if, as part of taking it forward, the Government will progress the review of indicators and measures associated with the curriculum to ensure not just sustainable teacher workload, but that the curriculum matches up with any requirements of a move towards a continuous assessment model?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Ross Geer for that question. I think he makes a really good point in relation to teacher workload in particular. We can't just assume that the current system is operating at optimum level, and we need to critically look, as we take this brief pause in relation to legislation, at the current qualifications to ensure they're fit for purpose and to ensure they're not driving teacher workload. So I'm happy to take that suggestion from Ross Greer away. Of course, in discussions yesterday, I think actually with the teaching unions, they made this point very strongly to me that we need to consider the impact that any reform will have in relation to teacher workload. Fundamentally, we want continuous assessment to drive better learning and teaching without high stakes exams at the end. And I think that's where we will get to in relation to the reform agenda. We need to support, though, the profession to get there. And I actually think that goes back to Willie Rennie's question in relation to the reform of these bodies. They will be key in driving the change that we
need
to see.
Thank you. I've got Sue Webber to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Cabinet Secretary, on the basis of your statement and the comment, it's not advice and guidance teachers want. It's very often practical help in responding to things like additional support needs, behaviour and relationships, and seeking to improve parental engagement. I was under the impression Education Scotland's role was to offer this practical help. If it's not, what are they doing?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member makes an interesting point. Education Scotland, of course, have a key role in that regard. One of the points I was struck by when I was bringing together these reports in the last few weeks was the role of our regional improvement collaboratives, which is why also within my statement I talked to reviewing the role of our regional improvement collaboratives, of course, who are staffed with people in Education Scotland, but also supported by our local authorities. I think it's important that improvement function is looked at to ensure it's fit for purpose. And of course, the challenges that Ms Webber has played back to me are ones which I would expect Education Scotland to support. And I think it's important we hear from the profession around about how we could perhaps better support some of that work going forward.
And very briefly, Ben McPherson.
The independent review and the national discussion have undertaken significant engagement about necessary and appropriate modernisation. Therefore, building on this, I wondered if the Cabinet Secretary could elaborate on how, going forward, the engagement will continue. She rightly emphasised the engagement with the teaching profession, but I presume engagement will continue also with learners, the business community and other relevant
Cabinet
stakeholders.
Secretary.
I thank Mr McPherson for his question. Of course, as he outlined, we had really substantive engagement in relation to the work of the national discussion, and I think it generated a level of enthusiasm for change in our system, which we've seen reflected in Professor Hayward's review too. It's hugely important, as the member outlines, that this isn't just about the teaching profession. They are key drivers within the system. But of course, our children and young people have to be part of that discussion as well. They were very much part, I should say, of Professor Hayward's review, and they also fed in substantively to the national discussion. But I expect to continue to work with our children and young people on the outputs from the reform in relation to our qualification system, but also to the member's point in relation to business too.